Muitos não sabem ler, escrever ou contar. Com um quociente intelectual inferior a 60, nossa sociedade os rotula de débeis mentais. Mas eles sabem cantar, dançar e tocar vários instrumentos. O mundo deles é a música.
Numa distribuição Sinapse. Músicos especiais.
Em 1961, um médico neozelandês, o Dr. Williams, foi o primeiro a identificar as características comuns entre alguns doentes mentais. O mesmo tipo de rosto, uma hipersensibilidade auditiva e sérios problemas cardiovasculares que limitam suas esperanças de vida. 30 anos mais tarde, em 1993, os cientistas conseguiram isolar o gene responsável pelo que chamamos de Síndrome de Williams, uma doença relativamente rara que atinge em média uma em cada 20 mil crianças. As crianças portadoras da doença apresentam uma outra característica mais inesperada, um dom particular para a música. Estamos no norte do estado de Nova York, em uma colônia de férias que, durante uma semana, abre suas portas para as crianças portadoras desse mal. Durante uma semana, elas vão poder trabalhar seu dom com músicos profissionais atraídos pela experiência. Hoje, o grupo prepara o espetáculo previsto para o fim de semana. Uma comédia musical onde as crianças descobrem as palavras e a música.
I was first completely taken aback by how talented they were. I wasn't expecting their abilities to be so excellent. They have unlimited possibilities. Each year we take them further and further musically. They're able to understand complex musical times and concepts. And each year we try to take them to a further place in music. And go! I tend to believe this story that the myths of pixies and elves may have developed from people meeting William's people and not having a name for what it was. They love to tell jokes, they love to make you laugh, they're very verbal, they communicate excellently, and they love to sing and dance for you. And I think many cultures have the myth of pixies and elves, and it seems a very logical assumption.
If someone can't really talk very well, they use sign language too.
So what do you use?
I use my voice or my hands or signs, like this is my way of saying I'm nervous, kind of. And when I go like that, that means I'm happy. When I'm sad, I go kind of like this. That's a sad pose. When I'm really happy, I go, "Kee!"
Umas 50 pessoas portadoras da Síndrome de Williams são recebidas a cada ano neste centro. O mais jovem tem 10 anos e o mais velho, 43. Durante uma semana, sua vida vai girar toda ao redor da música. Howard Lindhoff é biólogo. Pai de uma criança com a síndrome, ele se dedica ao estudo da doença. Ele constatou que muitas das crianças doentes têm o ouvido absoluto, um fenômeno muito raro que atinge uma em cada 10 mil pessoas. Um dom que permite adivinhar a altura das notas sem qualquer auxílio auditivo ou visual.
G. Yeah, G, not bad.
D.
Okay.
C.
Okay, high one, huh? All right. Can you sing
B, C?
Let's do B.
Okay.
B. Very good.
Thank you.
We do know that musicians with perfect pitch, that a certain part of their brain is called the left part of the planum temporale. And that part is enlarged in normal musicians who have absolute pitch. With Williams people, their brain is 80% the size of normal people. But the part, the planum temporale, the left planum, is about the same size of normal people. So relatively speaking, it is more part of the brain deals with pitch.
Essa particularidade se traduz em outras crianças por um sentido de ritmo excepcional. Aaron vem todo ano há 4 anos para este centro. Ao contrário de outras crianças, Aaron não gosta de falar com palavras. É com as baquetas que ele se comunica.
There are things that I have Aaron do that are even hard for typical students.
Like what?
Well, using the left hand to play the hi-hat, then switching the right hand to play the hi-hat. This is something that can be equated to sports, a batter that can bat right-handed and left-handed. Not everyone can do it. Aaron has a talent for also being ambidextrous. So he can program his right hand to do something and then erase it and tell his left hand to do it while his right hand is doing something completely opposite and then have it do the same thing again quickly. Aaron's got a very special way of communicating. Aaron is one of the only people I've ever met that can do this. Aaron will only look into my eyes. Aaron won't watch what I play. And I don't know if it's because he just has a great sense of hearing or he's communicating to me in almost a telepathic way. He doesn't watch what my hands or what my feet are doing, but he does it with me. Good job, Aaron. Perfect. Good job.
Nesta tarde, os melhores alunos do centro dão um concerto na igreja da cidade.
What's that that you're doing?
Well, this is my 5th year at the camp, and I'm gonna play a song called L'Orage on the piano, and it has to do with a storm. My name's Alex Sweezy.
University with a geneticist, and it was a teaching hospital, and they had many students. They probably had 12 people all around this tiny baby strapped on a table, and they had rulers, and they were measuring his eyes and measuring his legs, and I hated it. I just wanted to scoop him up and run away, and then the doctor left the room, and then she came back with a big medical textbook and opened it up and showed me, this is what your son has. this is how he looks now, and this is how he's gonna begin to look. And they told me it was a progressive disease. And I was just, I just couldn't believe it. I thought it was a very awful way to learn this. I was learning myself to play the piano, and I had him in his infant swing. And there was one song that I would play when I came to a certain note, and he matched the note. He was 3 months old.
On the piano?
3 months old on the piano. And he would sit in his little swing and go, ooh. And I looked at him, and I played the song again in the exact same point, and he matched it again. And I took the step, I took the note down a step, and he matched that. He, ooh. And I knew then that you had some kind of musical.
I usually like to hear the music that I'm playing and I really like music.
Do you feel different when you play music?
Sort of yes and sort of no, because some of the people can play really good, maybe even a little better than me, but some of the people don't even have that talent, so it's sort of sad for them. But for me, it's really pretty good.
I took out a machine. It looks like a big old monkey do. I don't care whatever you do. Oh, ho, ho, here I go. I'm going up, I'm coming down. So here we go.
This place is nice. I really like it here. People, normal people can't see their... the beauty, the happiness, and like for example, like when everyone is in a crowd, they can't see the person. Like people can see me and say, "You're lovely," but inside of me, there's a person who's. There's a person who's waiting for the real person. That's all I could think of.
Toda noite acontece um pequeno concerto na sala de espetáculos do centro. Normalmente, Tyler tocaria bateria, mas já faz um ano que ele estuda trombone, um instrumento particularmente difícil de tocar, pelo qual ele descobriu ter uma verdadeira paixão.
Playing along with them. I mean, I visualized it in my head that I was with them, but in real, it really doesn't happen that way.
But you would actually see people around?
Yeah, I would.
What sort of instruments?
Like trombones or tubas or trumpets or drums or something like that. the whole entire band will be right behind me. I would like to be in the marching band over at Clemson. You have to be in a high school. You have to have an experience from a high school. I went to high school, but I just didn't get a chance to do it. I really didn't have a chance. I didn't even go. I went to junior high, and they didn't even let me in. I mean, how pathetic is that?
And why do you think they did that?
Because they didn't, all they care about is their band. I mean, all they do is just care about them. They don't care who gets in or who doesn't get in. It hurts. It really, really hurts me inside right here.
Do you remember, like, when you first learned that you had the Williams syndrome? Did somebody tell you, explain to you? How did it happen?
My mama did. And all she said is that you have Williams syndrome, you're gonna have to fight through it. And that's what I've been doing. I've been fighting through it.
Was it tough for?
No, it's not tough. It's a little bit tough when people make fun of you. I mean, you don't want that to happen. I mean, come on. A disease is a disease. I mean, you just can't make fun of it.
Para tentar atenuar as dificuldades psicomotoras, os pacientes praticam todos os dias exercícios de eurritmia, uma forma de expressão corporal baseada em noções de harmonia e de ritmo.
One of my goals for them is that they will connect their feelingness about music with a knowingness about who they are in the world, that their tremendous sense of understanding music can help them to use the conversational aspects of music to learn to be more responsive, more aware. I'll give you a little introduction. Here we go, violins and guitars. Music is a conversation. And so I took apart the voices for them, and many of the groups call them a violin voice and the lower voice the cello voice. And I would have them choose which instrument, which voice they were going to follow musically, and sit with a partner and have a conversation, a gestural conversation without words. To see what would come, you know, where the places were in the music where both voices were talking at the same time. Can two things be going on at the same time, and can you still be responsive? Can you still be aware and not lose your place?
The Williams syndrome is very, it's like a puzzle. It's a big puzzle. When the puzzle is fit, you know the person. But when the puzzle is all scattered, you don't know them very well till the big puzzle is fit together.
Alguns pais vêm com seus filhos. É o caso de Lisa, que acompanha a filha Megan durante toda a semana.
It's such a joy to see our young people here and to see them grow into the gifts that have been given to them with their music. But there's also a sadness. I think that we need to, as parents, accept the limitations that our kids have and try to build on their strengths and try to help them cope with their weaknesses by educating them and helping them advocate more for themselves, because we can't always be there, and that's the hard part, you know? We can't always be there, and we're not always going to be here.
I'm going as fast as I would at the wheel. I'm taking a day and everything goes. With a seatbelt on, that's sure, I suppose. The trays are green.
A síndrome de Williams afeta as pessoas em níveis diferentes. A filha de Lisa, Megan, é uma das pacientes mais evoluídas intelectualmente. Mais lúcida que os outros, Megan vive com ainda mais dificuldades sua diferença.
I was made fun of a lot, and there's one word I really just hate, retarded. And when people call me that, I'm just like, whatever, you know, that's not me.
What do you answer them?
I tell them, what if you were in my shoes? If you were to step in my shoes, how would you feel about being in a special ed class all through your life? How would you feel if you only were friends with people that have different problems and not being with other people that don't as well? Learning that I'll live with this for the rest of my life and I might not be able to have kids or I might not be able to drive. That's one of the hardest things. Because I want to go out by myself. I'm 21 now and I'll be 22 this September. And if I don't go out anywhere, then where would I be? I would be lost. I would be a lost kitten.
There's no way a person would say, oh, I'd like to have Williams syndrome, please. It's just a gene, not like you can't get it from everybody else. But if it was a... But if everyone had Williams syndrome, then maybe you'll have a talented and nice people.
Desde que conhecemos as causas genéticas da síndrome de Williams, a pesquisa fez grandes progressos. A análise dos genes que faltam nas pessoas portadoras nos dão informações preciosas sobre nossa relação com a música e, de maneira mais geral, sobre o funcionamento do cérebro humano. Enfim, elas nos levam a ver o doente mental de uma nova maneira.
O que Williams people have shown us through our studies is that they have a lot to tell us if we understand how they think. But this should not just be for Williams people. I think the other syndromes, like Down syndrome, they also must know something different. They can't be depressed and everything. They must have peaks and valleys. I call this word, I use the word mentally asymmetric, which it tells, it's a nice word that it's not pejorative in any way. And we think that also in Down and other syndromes, they must have some peaks. And it's up to us to find out what those peaks are, their abilities. But we haven't done that yet. So hopefully, people will see what we've done with Williams syndrome, and then they will work with people in other syndromes as well. It may not be music, it may be something else entirely different.
Person and tell them what they're feeling inside, like in here, in the head.
You can do that?
Yeah.
So what's my feeling?
Well, you're happy. You're photographing me. I'm feeling kind of a little bit, how do you say, happy, but a little bit kind of in the middle happy.
What about him?
Tired.
Versão brasileira, Audio News.